So they just literally flew into Charlotte about 4 o'clock. So literally drove straight on down and came on to church. So, brother, we appreciate you, and we've been praying for you. And that was Miss Beverly Moore. That would have been Buford's sister. And already met up with Mama and Daddy. Amen. So praise the Lord. Met the Lord. And Miss Linda is still in the hospital, as I was telling you Sunday. They had cared her up. They admitted her. And they're going to go to rehab with her to try to build her back up. So I'm not trying to get ahead of myself with this long, long prayer list tonight. But those are some we just want to mention right out of the gate since Buford's back in town. And I appreciate Brenda helping us out both Sunday and again tonight. So let's go to the Lord and ask God to just give us a uplift tonight as we worship him. I appreciate the good turnout on a Wednesday night. Brother Ray Campbell, would you lead us in prayer tonight and get Wednesday night service underway, please? Yes, God. Amen.
Night, Lord, and I pray that you just open our ears and our hearts and our minds to hear your word.
Oh, help us, God.
We pray for those who shouldn't be here tonight, Lord.
Yes.
And I pray for all those who are on our prayer list, and I pray that you just wrap your loving arms around them, Lord, and comfort them and
give
them to be your will. Heavenly Father, we pray that you be with our pastor tonight as he brings your message to
us. Oh, help us, God.
Lord, we pray that you be with us later on this evening as we leave this place and help us to get to our destination safely. These things we pray in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And also, Sherry Lyles did have the heart surgery. The surgeon said it was one of the worst valves that he had ever seen. But she came through everything fine and doing well, all to the glory of God. And Terry even came on to church tonight, so we appreciate that. And she is, of course, still in the CVICU unit, maybe for another day or so. But anyway, we're just glad God's taking care of her. And that problem unfolded here a week ago tonight, so I'm glad that God's taking care of it. And Miss Mickey, I understand, has had pneumonia, and with her standing, I figure she must want to give a word. Amen. Amen. He's an awesome prayer answering God. Amen. All right, Brother Steve, let's sing a little bit tonight.
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Page 177. Thank you for coming tonight. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed?
In the soul cleansing blood.
lay aside the garments and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. He is a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
And also, I want to thank Larry for playing over there on that keyboard, too. We had gotten it a while back for the youth choir, and they kind of had been on a little bit of suspension with Greg having the surgery. So we appreciate Larry helping out and Brenda both. So let's receive the offering tonight, and on this particular night, everything goes toward the television ministry, so we like you to know what you're giving toward always. So, Brother John Blackwell, would you lead us again in prayer as we receive the offering tonight?
Thank you, Father God, for all these that's come out, Father.
Oh,
God.
Yes.
Amen. Father God. Lord, we just want to thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ,
yes.
Lord, coming down to Calvary and shedding his precious blood there for our sins, Father God. Lord, bless Preacher Sam as he brings the message.
Oh,
that
help us,
our
God,
tonight,
yes.
Father God, Lord, that all leave this homesick and home in the hospital, these in the hospice, and these that's gone down by the graveside, Father God. Bless Brother Buford and his family and all family members, Father God. Comfort them and bless them only as you can, Father God. Now, Father God, bless this offering for the TV ministry, Father God, that all these people that's home watching it, shut-ins all over the world, Father God, that's viewing our service, that their hearts may be touched and there'll be some saved, Father God. Lord, we just want to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. Thank you for every church member we have here. Bless any visitors we have here tonight, Father God. Lord, we just want to praise the name of Jesus. So worthy to be praised in these latter days, Father God. Lord, that you're the only thing that's so worthy to be on our mind. Jesus Christ, our Lord and our soon coming Savior. Lord, bless us. Forgive us where we fail you. In Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.
Johnny Pierce, come on around and sing for us tonight.
I'm going to be Brandon tonight. I think he was supposed to sing. Steve just grabbed me here. So I guess I'll say shame on the devil, huh? Is that suitable? Okay. No, I sang this Sunday morning. I didn't have anything with me, but I had left this laying up there. I've been touched. Great song.
Amen.
I was heavy burdened down. The hand of Satan had me bound.
will never take away from me. And that's Jesus who's living within. For I've been touched by those hands that were hanging on a tree.
Amen. There we go. Turn with me tonight, if you would, to the book of John, chapter number 6. John, chapter 6. I want to give you a moment to find your place. Not that the book of John is that hard to find, but I just wonder tonight if it might be somebody else that might want to give a word of testimony. I know a minute ago Mickey had stood up and every now and then we offer that opportunity. So, Miss Francis and then Miss Hattie. Go ahead back there, Miss Francis.
My granddaughter had a demonic problem.
Yep.
That's right.
Out of their life. Amen to that. Miss Hattie.
Praise God. Amen.
Those grandbabies, no doubt about it. And the baby was in the hospital. Somebody else might want to give a quick word. I got one over here. Yes, ma'am.
Amen. I don't have my cane tonight. I don't have my knee straps on. On my own, and I'm so thankful. But it was some prayers for all of y'all. And I love you. I appreciate you.
Amen.
Thank the Lord that I'm doing good.
Thank you.
God bless you. Love all of you. Thank you so much. We love you, preacher.
Amen. God bless you. Murtis had been down for quite a while, and it's good to see her back up. Amen. Anybody else? Just a quick word. I'm sorry. Back here, Miss Shirley.
Amen.
Let's give you an opportunity to brag on God, Miss Melanie.
I just want to thank God for the church again, and thank God for my family, and that we're, you know, alive.
Amen.
So,
amen.
I just want to give God the glory.
Amen. He's good all the time. Whether it's something special happened to us or not. Amen. He's good all the time. What was Brother Ehrman?
Preacher Sam, I'd like to say tonight
sleep all right. And really enjoyed it out there. I talked to my daughter while ago. We got 8 inches of snow today.
Guess you're glad you're out of there, though.
When I got off that plane, I smelled this Sacramento air. I said, it smells better here.
I believe that, brother. Amen. I sure do. Amen. Anybody else? Just quick word. I'm not fishing, but if you, we haven't done it in a while, Laura. See that situation? It went over there and the child in the pediatric intensive care, and everything totally changed from a day or two. God just stepped in. Amen to that. All right, probably last call now. Anybody got something? Miss Natty. Miss Nettie's son had had surgery a week or two back, so continue to remember Russell. Amen. All right. Amen. Okay, John chapter number 6, would you stand tonight? I want to share a whole different thought with you tonight. This is not something I'd bring on a Sunday. So I'm saying this with respect to the fact that I believe you are spiritually minded, or I wouldn't be bringing the message. And I also believe tonight that you've grown enough in the Lord that you know truth from error. Somebody give me an amen. But I want to preach tonight, or title the message, and you're going to have to look up here because I'm going to have to kind of add something to it. You'll understand in a minute. I want to bring the message on hard preaching with about 3 question marks behind the phrase hard preaching. John chapter number 6 and verse 60. It's a long chapter. Chapter 6 and then verse 60, here's what the Bible says. I want you to listen closely as we read His Word, and we're going to show you a good many verses tonight. The Bible said, John chapter 6, verse 60, many, therefore, of His disciples, when they had heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can hear it, or who can take that in? When Jesus knew in Himself that His disciples, oh my soul, murmured at it, He said unto them, or asked this question, doth this offend you? Jesus now, Scott, you know, all of us want to believe that those disciples that knew Jesus personally, those disciples that knew Jesus by the sound of His voice, if you heard me in Walmart, you'd know it was me by my voice. And how many of you, I could pick you out by your voice. Those disciples knew Jesus that well that they saw Him do miracle after miracle. They were present, Brother Chuck, when Jesus raised some from the dead, when He healed those that were sick, and they knew Jesus that personally. In my mind, I want to put those disciples way up here as super saints. But guess what? Some of them were not super saints. Notice the word. The first word in verse 60 says, many. This wasn't one or two backsliders in the crowd. Many, I'm going to read it again. Many, therefore, of, and it was not speaking of the bootleggers, if there were bootleggers in that day. He's not speaking about any other crowd. Many, therefore, of His disciples, when they heard that, said, "This is a hard saying." And then Jesus knew that his own disciples were murmuring at what he said. Jesus then asked the question, "Doth this offend you?" Hard preaching. Question mark, question mark, question mark. If anybody thinks preaching is hard, that's because they're soft. Too soft on sin, too soft on their standards or their belief of the Word of God. I want to share this unusual thought with you tonight, and let's pray, and then you may be seated. Father, we do thank you, God, for the privilege and the opportunity to be in your house tonight. I ask, Father, that you would just meet with us on this Wednesday night. I thank you, God, for each and every person that's made their way to the house of God tonight, and a good crowd tonight up here of adults, and then the children and the youth workers in the back. Father, we just thank you for the way you bless Gethsemane and for all that you've done for us. And God, let us review our own lives tonight and our own thought process regarding truth, and let us ask ourselves the question tonight, would there even be such a thing in actuality as hard preaching? I just pray, God, you'd get our attention now. Have your will and way. And Father, we do pray it and we ask it now. Help us with this teaching, a lesson in this thought tonight. Father, we do pray it tonight. We ask it in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said tonight, amen and amen. Thank you. And you may be seated. You know, folks, I've been doing this for a while. I've been preaching now for approaching 40 years. It's hard for me to believe that, but it's true. And listen, down through the years, every now you know me, and you know that I try to have a heart for people. I might preach, and I might get a little loud, and I might get a little rambunctious, and I might get carried away, but people that know me know that I have a heart for people, and I love people, and I would never ever try to hurt anybody. Now, I'm saying that with my hand raised before God, but every now and then, somebody might say, not to me, but it'll get back to me, well, the preacher just preached a little bit too hard. I've been accused of being a fire-breathing dragon. And then one time somebody said, "I don't like that preacher." And they asked why. They said, "Because he preaches about being happy." I mean, they love their misery. This particular person wallowed in their sorrow. And, mister, they loved it when they were down because they just loved somebody to pet them. And they said, I made the statement one time that God saved you and you on your way to heaven. You missed out on hell. You ought to be happy. And they got mad and offended that I said you ought to be happy in the Lord. Well, you just frown all over hell, I guess. Amen. Not trying to be mean-spirited, but wait a minute. I want you to know that's nothing new. You say, "Brother Sam, what do you mean it's nothing new?" They did it back in the days of Jesus. And Jesus had preached, the master preacher, the one that is God in human flesh, the one that had a bigger heart than all of us put together. I'm talking about the God that took my sin and your sin and rolled it on him and died for our sin and then rose for our justification and ascended back to the right hand of the Father to take us one day into the Father's house. But that man with that much love and compassion and grace, and not the bootleggers and not the hell raisers, but some of his own disciples, after Jesus preached, they said, "That's a hard saying. I don't believe anybody can get a hold of that," they said. Jesus looked around and You know, I believe he could read a crowd pretty well. Not only just because he had good vision, but he's God. And he knew that some of them had begun to murmur. And Jesus then asked them, he said, does my preaching offend you? Can I show you what Jesus had just preached? Back up in chapter 6. Stay in chapter 6, but back up to verse 29. Verse 29. Let's see verse 28 for context. Then said they unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered unto them, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he has sent. Now, how in the name of heaven could you be offended at somebody that said, you don't have to get down on your knees and walk 40 miles on your knees till you wear the bones out, and you don't have to say 400 Hail Marys, and I pay the priest. Somebody talk back to me tonight. He said, if you want to do the work of God, the main work that you do is believing on the Son of God. I'm glad tonight I'm not saved because I'm a preacher. I'm not saved because I pass out tracts. I'm not saved because of this or that. I'm saved tonight because I made a decision long ago to believe on the one that God hath sent, and he's taken my sin and died with it on the cross and has birthed me into the family of God. But somebody got upset with Jesus. Jesus asked him, can you be offended the fact that I ask you to believe? See, people think it's just too easy. Y'all talk to me tonight. Don't dry up on me. I'll come back out there. So many times people think, I got to do this and I got to do that. Now, I believe in repentance and living a changed life, but that's something God does after you get right with him. Amen. I believe in clean living and living under the anointing power of the Spirit of God. But God will clean you up when he gets on the inside of you. But the main work that you've got to do is believe on the one that God the Father hath sent. And they got offended at that. Now, I know all of y'all pretty well. I'm sure you've never been offended. Anything the teacher's ever taught, and I'm so soft-spoken and easygoing. I'm sure you've never been offended at anything I've ever said. But I want to show you some things tonight here in the Bible. Believing on the Lord is not unreasonable. The Lord was not asking too much of them for them to believe on him. And the Bible said that was in verse 29, several verses later, they said, oh, that's a hard saying. I don't understand how we can do that. And Jesus perceived and he knew that there they were, and they were murmuring about Jesus. And he just asked them plainly, does it offend you to believe in the Lord? Having said that tonight for kind of a long introduction, I want to show you tonight how wimpified and how soft that somebody would have to be to believe that preaching is too hard. I want to show you some things tonight by the help of God. First of all, there have been those, number one, that thought the spiritual life was too hard. See, let me tell you what the Lord said, and then I'm going to make an application. Let me tell you what the Lord said, and I don't think this is unreasonable. The Lord said not to have any other gods, little G-O-D-S, any other gods before me. Now, put that on the screen tonight so everybody know we're right down the line. Exodus 20, verse 3, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Now, wait a minute. Some people want to get offended. They think God's being too hard. But let me say this tonight. Every lady here in the auditorium tonight will tell you in a heartbeat that she expects to be first to her husband. To have no other women before me. Somebody say amen. I said this is country now. Amen. And every man here tonight will tell you straight out, he expects that there be no other men before him in his eyes, in the eyes of his wife. Am I right? Now you expect it, men expect it, and women expect it. So what is so unreasonable and so hard that the Lord said, after saving you and delivering you and blessing you and answering prayer for you, how is it unreasonable that the Lord would say you have no other gods before me? I think really and truly that ought to go without saying. Somebody say amen. That's good. Hey, I'm going to ask anybody here tonight, is there anybody, we had a testimony meeting a minute ago, is anybody here be willing to stand up tonight and say that God has not been good to you? Is anybody here tonight going to stand up and say that God has been mean to me? No, sir, whether you're saved or you're a visitor or just happened up here tonight, I guarantee you not a single person can say that God has done you wrong. So by the mere fact that God has blessed you and taken care of you and met your need and see that you've had something to eat and clothes to wear and a warm place in the winter, somebody say amen. I don't think it's unreasonable of God to preach and to say you should have no other gods before me. I hope I'll embarrass anybody that thinks preaching's hard. If you think preaching's hard, it's because you're soft. Soft on sin. Oh, and let me tell you this next one. Oh, some people think God's just so unreasonable and the Lord preached so hard. By the way, what you got to remember, when Jesus preached, when he was on the earth, he didn't preach from the New Testament because it hadn't been written. He was living it out at the time. What Jesus preached from was from the Old Testament. Have no other gods before me. And then the Lord came up with a whole brand new concept. Oh, I know this is hard for some people, but he said, love thy neighbor. Boy, he's just being so unreasonable. Boy, that's hard preaching. That preacher expects us to love somebody. Show me the verse. Make sure we hadn't misquoted something. And the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. Now that's what Jesus said as he was preaching and it was being recorded as it was happening. Can I say to you tonight that I don't think we can charge the Lord with being too hard. He's asked you to believe. He's asked you to love. And he's asked you to put him first. Now wait a minute. You're the biggest hypocrite in town to get mad at God. You expect your wife to love you. You expect to be first to her. Somebody give me an amen. And you want her to believe in you. And listen, that's all that God has asked out of us. And God has been better to us than we have been to our spouses. Amen. How can we charge God? That's what I'm saying. Hard preaching? Question mark, question mark, question mark. I believe it's a myth. I don't think there's anything such as hard preaching. It's truthful preaching. And then there are those that think the Lord's too hard when it comes to serving him. Now let me tell you what the Lord said. God said, and it's recorded, and we'll show you in a minute, and the scripture has told us, and Jesus said, that no man can serve two masters. He cannot serve God and mammon, and the word mammon, M-A-M-M-O-N, means mankind, or the world system. You got to choose one or the other, just like us today. Now, you can work two jobs, but you're going to have to work one on the first shift and the other one on the second, or one on the third and one on the first, but you cannot work two jobs on the first shift at the same time. And the Lord's not being unreasonable. He said, you can't serve two masters. You're going to have to serve me or the world, one or the other. That's not hard preaching. That is sensible preaching that God is helping me to see that I am limited within myself, and without him, I'm nothing. Show me the verse, please. Next one. Wait a minute. That's one I didn't put in the computer. But you know it. No man can serve two masters, and it's in there. But now about serving, notice what he says. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. And guess what? He that winneth souls is wise. The Lord did not say, if you don't win souls, you're going to go to hell. He did not say, if you don't win souls, I'm going to punish you. He did not say, if you don't win souls, I'm going to judge you or put a curse on you. All he said is, the one that wins souls is wise. That's not an unreasonable statement. But so many people think God's just so hard and so rough. He tells us on one occasion, lift up your eyes and look out to the harvest. Somebody say amen. And let me tell you a verse, and I sure am glad this verse is in the Bible. I want to get down here one more time, at least. The Lord said, I want everybody to hear this. He said, take up your cross and follow me. I think we got that one. Yep, there it is. Then said Jesus unto his disciples. Same crowd that was whining. Amen. And then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. I'm going to tell you why I am thrilled to death that verse is in the Bible. He said, take up your cross. He didn't say, if you're going to follow me, you got to go die on a cross too. No, sir. When they crucified people, and you've seen it done when we got this little trap door right here on this platform, when we have the Easter play, and we got that big cross here, and Brother Chris Dean played Jesus for several years, and we got the smaller crosses over here, and they raised that up, and they dropped that cross down into this socket right here, that opening on the top of Mount Calvary. They had these holes drug there, and they would drop the cross. They had nailed them to it lying on the ground. They'd raise them up and drop them in it. But when you take up a cross, that means you remove it from its socket. Did you catch that? I was hoping for a little better response here. That meant you don't have to die on a cross. You take that cross up and you just follow me. I'm glad tonight, I thank God, in order for me to be saved, that I didn't have to go and die on a cross just like Jesus did, but I accept his sacrifice as my sacrifice. I belong to him. He's my father. I'm his son, and all I got to do is take up the cross and follow him. Man, he's not being hard. People said, I got to take up my cross. All that means, nutcase, is you don't have to die on one. Take it up. Get it out of its socket. And just follow Jesus. Hallelujah. Woo! Man, I rejoice that I don't have to die on a cross. And then some people think that their church life is too hard. Show me Hebrews 10:25. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting or encouraging one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. What day? He's talking about the day of the Antichrist and the day of the tribulation and the day of the false prophet and the day called the tribulation as it comes. And as we get closer and closer to that, so much the more we're going to need encouragement. You're not going to get it down there in the beer joint. You're not going to get it out in the world. The only place you're going to find the encouragement to keep you going when hell gets in your backyard is finding it among God's people. And it says, don't forsake the assembly. What's the assembling of ourselves together? That's what we've done tonight. We come together. Some live in Iva, some live in Starr, some live in Anderson, some live in Belton, some live in Williamston. And we've all come, Hartwell, and people come together to worship. We have assembled ourselves together. And some people think that if the preacher said, he's being too hard. No, listen, it will help you by doing it because, look, we're going to have to be encouraged when hell beats down on us and it's only going to get worse as time goes on. How many of you old enough that you can remember back 40, 50 years? I can, and many of you can. And, mister, we've been on a, it didn't matter which administration was in the White House. It didn't matter what party it was, but we have consistently gone downhill over the last 40 years. And I expect it to be, I hope things will be better in some areas, but as a general rule, we're going to be going downhill because we're heading toward the coming of the Antichrist. And the Bible has already said, there'll be a falling away first, and then the man of sin would be revealed. So look, folks, when somebody, we're not being too hard when we say that we ought to be faithful to the house of God, but we're saying that not for our benefit, for the benefit of each person that comes to get charged up so he can be exhorted, which means encouraged, and so much the more as things get worse, we're going to need one another more than we ever have. I've told the story before about the kid that had fallen in that farm pond. And one got in over here and one got in over there. And they went in thrashing with their feet and with their arms in the water trying to find that kid. And finally somebody said, wait a minute, everybody come here. And they got up there and they all joined arms. This one here put his arm that way and the one beside him put his arm that way. And they made a human chain. And they went down into that farm pond, and with that human chain, there was no areas they missed, and they found that child. Somebody said, oh, I wish we'd have joined together sooner than what we did. Let me tell you, we're going to have to join arms with one another. Because, listen, as hell comes against us, as more and more, listen, on your job, people tell me all the time that are out on public work, more and more and more they're made fun of if they wear a Christian. And matter of fact, a lot of people cannot wear a Christian T-shirt or anything that says anything about God on public works and how we've been mocked and made fun of and we've been losing our rights for quite a while now. Y'all talk to me tonight as believers, and we're going to need, as we see that day approaching, we're going to need one another more and more. So listen, it is not unreasonable, and it is not somebody being too hard to expect after all the faithfulness God, he's been faithful to me. He was faithful to send his son. He was faithful to raise him from the dead. He was faithful to lift him up and take him back to heaven. He was faithful to give me his word. He was faithful to give me godly parents. He was faithful to send godly people my way. He was faithful to save me. And then when I've called on him, he's been faithful to answer my prayer. And I'd be the biggest hypocrite in town to not be faithful to the one that loved me and has done that much for me. Amen. It is not being too hard not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some. Now, there's legitimate things, of course. I'm talking about goofing off. Somebody give me an amen. And what about the next one? When Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. Proof verse, Matthew 6, 33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things be added unto you. Quoted it right to a T. Let me tell you what, if you want these other things, all these things down here in these bottom two, if you want them to be added unto you, you're going to have to seek God first. God has got to be first in our life. When you decide you're going to get married, if you got half a brain, and I already use the illustration of husbands and wives putting each other first, but if you got half a brain, you know that somebody else can't be first, and then your marriage work. So, but why is it that we think God, we can treat him any kind of way we want to treat him, and we can put him about third or fifth or eighth or tenth on our list of importance, and it'll be all right? And we as a society been living down there about eighth or tenth place with God. And then when some preacher preaches that he needs to be first, they say, he's being too hard. When you think it's hard, it's because you're too soft. You say, Brother Sam, has somebody said or done something? Well, my hand raised to God, nobody said a thing. I'm just preaching what God laid on my heart. I promise you, I'm with my hand raised, both hands. Nobody said anything, at least not lately, about me being hard. So I'm not retaliating, I'm just preaching, amen. And then what about that when the Lord tells us how to deal with other people? When people say, oh, hey, that's being too hard. You know what the Lord said? Pray one for another. I don't think that sounds too hard to me. Proof verse. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much, but the main thought right there is to pray one for another. What can be so hard that God wants you to pray for somebody? But boy, some of these spiritually immature people are always talking about, well, it is being too hard. Praying for one another and being healed. If you're sick, do you think that's too hard? Does not he say, line number three, that ye may be healed? As I see that, that's conditional, and the Lord brings healing to those that have prayed for somebody else. Is that why you see that? Y'all talk to me tonight. Is that what the scripture said? Pray one for another that ye may be healed. If I never prayed for anybody else, and then if I got sick and then I begin to bombard heaven for me, the Lord's going to look down and say, you know what? You have not prayed for anybody, and now here you self-righteous, selfish man. You're coming to me wanting me to do something for you. And here you are, you want healed of bronchitis. Or you want healed from sore toenails. And there's a brother or sister over there that's had a heart attack. That one over there has had a stroke. That one over there has had a cancer. And you haven't prayed for them at all, but you want me to heal you of your sore toe? Man, y'all getting so quiet. I like when we get a little livelier than this. If you can't say amen, say, oh, me. He said, pray. Now, that's not too hard. Pray for one another that you be healed. That's what the Bible said. But somehow or another, people try to mistakenly say, well, the Bible's just too hard. Did you know the Bible even is so concerned about other people and their feelings and their well-being? The Bible said that if you have respect of other people, I don't mean respect in our word. What I mean is show preference to somebody else, that it's sin. If you treat a poor man one way and you treat a rich man another way, do you know the Bible said that's sin? God cares so much about those common, ordinary people that he says to his own people, now look, if you show difference among people, you've sinned. I think we got that verse in there. Let's go to the next one, see what we got. Oh, but if you have respect to persons, ye commit sin. If somebody came in here tonight and they got on overalls, and don't know that anybody does. If you do, I didn't even see that. But if you came in with a pair of overalls and a T-shirt and Brogan boots tonight, and you came in the house of God and somebody said, that old dumb foreign boy, we'll let him sit at the back. And then somebody else comes in and they got on cufflinks, fancy clothes, and you come right on down. We want you to sit right down front. And make a big deal over it. The Bible said when you show respect to persons in that regard, then you have sinned. Why did God tell us that? Because he wants those poor people that can't afford the cufflinks and the fancy shoes and the $500 or $1,000 suit to be just as comfortable in the house of God as the multimillionaire. Somebody say amen. And he said, when you show a difference of people, you've committed sin. God is not being hard toward people. He's being a blessing and a help. Amen. Man, I don't know how his own disciples could say, this is a hard saying. You just told us to believe. Jesus said, surely you're not offended. I'm paraphrasing. I know what the King James says, but he was kind of saying, what? You're offended at this? It's kind of what the Bible says. Amen. Let's move on a little further. And then some, especially the modernists, they just think the Word of God's too hard. Let me show you the number one verse that modernists think is too hard. Show me the next one we put in the computer. In whom we have redemption through his what? Blood. The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. That's the number one hated verse of the modernists and the false religion, because it's talking about we're being redeemed, redemption, and it happens through his blood. Let me tell you right now, if you're off on vacation, you decide to go to church and you're off somewhere, that's a good thing. But if you go before the service ever starts, flip through the song book. And if you don't see any songs about the blood, you can pretty well rest that that's not a preaching, true, Bible-believing church. Because, listen, we have redemption through his blood. It's not the fact that I've tried to keep the commandments or I've turned over a new leaf. Honey, listen to me. I'm redeemed by the blood of Jesus. The Bible said we're not redeemed by corruptible things such as silver and gold, but by the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without spot or blemish. Hallelujah. And then he says, after you redeem, then he says, you get the forgiveness of sins. And then it knocks a lot of these false doctrines in the head, because it comes according to the riches of his grace. G-R-A-C-E. God's riches at Christ's expense. That means it's the free gift of God. Yeah, man. So the modernist says that's too hard. I'll be honest with you, I've never looked at that as having anything hard in it at all. The only thing hard was for Jesus when he shed his blood. The only thing hard maybe is to make something out of us. But he did it, and he gave us. And then there's another verse that tears some of them up. When it says, the day of the Lord will come. Show me that one, please. Oh, yeah, here it is. You already got it up. 2 Peter. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. Now, hold on right there. There's a lot of preaching material and teaching material, but I just want to hit on that right there. He's coming as a thief in the night. Now listen, you have never gone to your mailbox and opened up and have a fancy little emboss with gold design around it and opened it up and said, I'm a thief and I'm coming to your house such and such a night. You're invited to leave your best silver out, unplug the TV where I won't have to tear up the socket. No, thieves always surprise you. And some of them try to make out like that there's no such thing as the rapture with the Lord coming. And it's going to, here's what some people say, society's going to get better and better and better. And God's going to look down and say, man, they're so good, I think I'll just go join them. Oh, no. Society has gotten worse and worse and worse. It's going to end up with the tribulation period. Said the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. That's what the Lord thinks about this world. Sinful and wicked. Give me an amen. And there's another one that says Jesus Christ is declared to be the Son of God. Romans 1. And declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Boy, some of these false religions, they hate that verse. That one's just way too hard for them. First of all, it declares Jesus to be the Son of God. They want to say that he's another prophet like some of the others. And then it talks about the Spirit of holiness, and that eats some of them up because they're living so unholy. And then when it says by the resurrection of the dead, some of them believe that the resurrection was only in spirit. Let me tell you something. If you want to believe the resurrection was only in a spirit, that's up to you. But let me tell you what, I believe that spirit was in a body when it rose. I believe in the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ. And listen, if my dad and my mother are out there at Forest Lawn Cemetery, and if that's the end of that, other than their spirit or something that I can't see or I can't hug or I can't hold or ever see again, honey, that doesn't do much for me. But I'm glad, thank God, there's going to be the resurrection of the body. Brother Buford, that dear sister of yours y'all buried yesterday has already met your mama and daddy, but there's going to be a resurrection, and this thing is real, and it's bodily, and I don't see that it's too hard, but that right there tears some of these religionists up. I'm nearly finished. And then the Lord, here's something that gets me. I'm going to show you this one, and we'll probably tie it together tonight. But lost people are always talking about how hard a standard that the Bible has, how hard it is to live for the Lord. I'm going to show you something that doesn't seem real hard to me. I've already talked about believing, but look at that verse. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Man, I was burdened down. I had a heavy weight around me before I got right with God, and it was just like I was walking around with a set of barbells on my shoulders all the time. I felt weighted down. And listen, Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Man, when I came to him, he reached over and took the heavy burden off of me. And even though we might labor for the Lord, it's not like life is a daily struggle. He's removed that labor, and I'm at rest in my heart, and I'm at rest in my soul. And I know that, listen, folks, the Bible says there remaineth a rest for the people of God. One day we'll sit down by the river. We'll enjoy all that heaven has. So listen, I want you to know, and nobody said anything, I raised my hand before God. But I know in years past, and I've been out there with the world, and I've talked to people, and so many people think, oh, Christianity's just too hard, and sometimes the preacher is preaching too hard, and the standard of the church is too hard. When you see these kind of things, how in the name of heaven can we call the love of God too hard? The Bible said Jesus looked out and saw, and the Bible said this, he was moved with compassion. As he looked out over the multitudes, he was moved with compassion as he saw them scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Compassion, love, grace, mercy, rest, peace. Man, I hope you got some of this tonight. And I hope the next time somebody that doesn't understand diddly about the things of God and say, well, a preacher's just too hard, and the church is too hard, and the doctrine's too hard, and the Bible's too hard, and this, that, and the other. I hope you'll have something to come back. Let them know. If you don't remember anything else, remember Matthew 11:28. Said, yeah, let me show you how hard it is. Come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. That's a good promise of God. Let me tell you something. If it was hard serving God, let me tell you, then the Bible would be a lie. Here's what the Bible says. The way of the transgressor is hard. Going out there and getting drunk night after night, having your head all swollen the next morning, reaching back to get your wallet to go buy some BC headache powders. And you reach back there and you don't have a wallet. Your wallet's gone because you spent everything. You got drunk and the one you thought was your best friend took your wallet and stole it from you. Huh, come on. And then you reach back up in there and you said, what's that right there? And then you get a mirror and look and you had stitches in the top of your head. But you're stupid enough to say, well, we had a good time last night. When they took that bowl of barstool and cracked you over the head, oh, we had a good time. So when the Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard, it's hard to live out there. You're making it hard on yourself. You're robbing yourself of blessings and joy and peace. And I think I've made my case tonight. I won't just belabor the point on and on, but don't ever think that the church or the Bible has too hard of a standard. I thank God for grace and mercy and love and forgiveness and hope and peace and joy. The angel said, for unto you is born this night in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And he went on and talked about peace. And then the Bible says you can have peace that passes all understanding. Hard preaching? Question mark, question mark, question mark. If you think preaching is hard, it's because you're too soft. No question mark there. Period after that. Or exclamation mark after that. Father, we love you tonight. We do thank you for all you've done for us. And Lord, you've been so good. Lord, sometimes people out in the world that they just don't understand the concept of God or the goodness of God or the things of God, and they mistakenly believe that the standard of the church is too hard and trying to be in church faithfully is just too hard. Let them realize, God, that that is nothing more than a trick of Satan. And help us, God, to understand this truth. We pray it and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. As Sister Brenda and Brother Larry play for us tonight, would you stand, please? I'm going to ask whatever church officers are here tonight, come on down. We're not going to belabor things. You come on, do business with the Lord tonight. Talk to him. The altar is open. Thank you.
Father, tonight we just want you to know that we love you. And Lord, the world is so confused. Help us, God, I pray, to never add to that confusion. But let us, God, never look at the things of God as being too hard. Let us certainly signal to the world that salvation is the easiest thing they can ever do. And the way of the transgressor is hard, living a life, drugs and alcohol and a broken financial status and later on broken health and broken marriages and broken homes and broken children. Let us realize the way of the transgressor is hard. Have your will and way tonight, God. Help us to accept the truth of God. You never make an unreasonable demand of your children. We ask it, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Those that are praying, would you continue? Others be seated, and we'll we're into a few minutes into overtime, but not that long. But very quickly, let me tell you, you can still get in on Bible college early on. I just started last Thursday night. Tomorrow night will just be the second class of the year. Got plenty of time to get in on it. Also, this coming Sunday, the friends and family of Dee and Mia Anthony will be giving them a baby shower here at the church from 3 to 5:30. This is the son and the daughter-in-law of Daniel and Carla Anthony, and this will be their first grandchild, which is a granddaughter. On our prayer list, and we've got a long one, please bear with me, the military in our nation, Shirley, Richard Payton, Helen White, Sherry Lyles, Phil Tyner, Deborah Hanna, Bob Humphrey, Jim Lomax, Jamie Rudder, Jamie Burdett, Sal De La Rosa, Brad Grogan, Jason Cobb, Loretta Cox, Brian Merritt, Jack and Georgia Schick, but especially Jack, David Dickerson under hospice care, Ramona Gentry, Russell Stansel, Ann Dalton and the new baby, Jimmy Kelly, Cindy Turner, Mary Cornett, Athena Patches, Patsy Moore's been hospital, Mickey Feltman is back, but continue to pray for her. Ed Smith, Elaine Burdett, Daniel Meek's been in hospital, Linda Cook at the hospital, David and Terry Oakley, Howard Crocker, Carly, or maybe it's Gary Allison, Jessica McCall, Ronald Williams with some heart issues, and I believe may end up with heart surgery tomorrow. Jerry Cox, Ada Boucher, 4 months old, but got good word. Marcia Dagnall, then all these sign-ins from just tonight. Francis Leverett, the Palmer family. I believe it's Nancy Smith. Grace Finley with testing. Linda and Bobby Gunter, Molly Pitts, Judy Crook, Sean DeMays. I believe I just mentioned that one. Christine Phillips, and Amanda Hudson and family traveling. Mitch Gunter, Linda Gilliland, Storm Stewart, Brian Loftus, Tony Smith's family, his dad has passed away. Marty Chapman, Kate, I believe it's Andrea, Johnny and Josie McElrath, or Jesse, I'm not sure, Brent Phillips, Debbie McGregor, Angie Adams, Nancy Lewis, Richard Johnson. Oh, also with a special business meeting in their church in New York. Kelly Burke, Ralph Partain, Danny and Kathy Moore, Byron Butch and Brian Moore, Steve Looney, Max and Amanda Brown, Sandra Powell, Ken Hoffman, Annette Bridges, Judy Bannister, Ronnie Smith, Richie, Denise, and Tyler Fortune, Kinsley Morgan with surgery, also... I believe it's the Brown family, David, I believe David Smith, they've written pretty small for me anyway, Robert Estrich, Ann Jones, Bo Pierce. I've been by Bo's house a couple times lately, and I didn't know it, but he's been under some hospice care, and I was there last week and again this week. Already mentioned the Moore family, Buford's sister. The McCullough family, that is Brenda Owensby's mother up in Kentucky. Brenda's mother has passed, and naturally they're in Kentucky, and that funeral will be tomorrow. And then Jerry and Mary McKinley, Ted Hilton, I was about to see him, and that's Shirley Yaley's brother, and they don't give him much hope. I already mentioned that one. Brooklyn Chastain, Richard and Martha Hammond, both have a virus. Heart-wise, Richard's doing great, so his absence has nothing to do with that, just the bug going around. And then Serena Hammond, Doyle Fields, that's not that Wayne Fields, wherever he is, not that Wayne Fields' dad, but the other Wayne Fields. And then Sue Rowe and Cindy Williams may have to have hip replacement. Johanna, Daniel Anthony with tests, Chase Anthony with the flu, Marvin Landers, and then these families in bereavement, and I promise we'll be finished. The Nix/Ellison family, that's Richard Ellison right here. The Fowler, the Sullivan, the Lowe, the Littleton, the Bridges, the Hamby, the Moore, and the Cleveland families, all in bereavement. So may the Lord bless each of those. If you have any others, let's let them be unspoken. We were going to ask you to help us move some tables tonight, but it's taken care of for tomorrow. So, Larry, I've not dropped the ball. It's taken care of for Bible College for tomorrow. Let's go ahead and pray. Ask the Lord's blessing, and we'll be dismissed. Let's just pray. Brother Tony Shaw, how about, brother, if you would, close us in prayer, good brother. Brother Tony.